Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, we're going to look at mental control. We're going to ask just how much control we have over our own minds. Now, in the previous video, I talked about the idea of selective attention. We have this narrow focus, and we filter out all of the other things that are irrelevant. And one thing that we saw is we don't have full control over this narrow focus of attention. Because let's say you're at a cocktail party, and you suddenly hear your name in a conversation behind you, and your attention sort of immediately shifts to that. It kind of feels like you didn't choose to do that, it just happened, right? It's outside of your conscious control. Now, we also see this in things like if you're walking in the woods and a snake crosses your path, you'll suddenly jump, right? You'll be startled. And this isn't a conscious process. You didn't look at the snake and say, well, that's a snake and snakes are potentially dangerous and so I should probably get out of the way and so I think I'll jump back. No, it happened much faster than that. You jumped back before you even recognized that it was a snake. Right? So you didn't really have control consciously over that behavior. Now, another way we can see a lack of control is when it comes to trying not to think of certain things. So if I ask you not to think of a white bear, of course, you end up thinking of a white bear. And this effect is even stronger if you really try not to think of a white bear. So this brings us to a study by the late Daniel Wegner, who I had the good fortune of taking a seminar with when I was in college. And what Wegner did is he asked people to try to suppress their thoughts. So if you went into this lab, you might be asked, okay, for the next few minutes, you can think about whatever you want, and if you happen to think of a white bear, press this counter here, and we'll keep track of how many times you think of white bears. But other people are given this thought suppression challenge. So they're told, don't think of white bears. So think of whatever you want, but avoid thinking about white bears. And if you think of one, press this button, and we'll keep track. And it turns out people who are told not to think of white bears end up thinking of white bears more than people who are told, you know, if you think of a white bear, you know, let us know. All right, so this shows this ironic process of mental control. So this is the idea that, you know, we get the opposite effect of what we're intending to do, right? So it's counter-intentional, right? We try not to think of white bears, and it causes us to think of white bears more often. Now, one proposed explanation for this is that we have this monitoring process, which is checking our thoughts to make sure they're not white bears. And as a result, you know, every time we think a thought, this monitoring process is, was that a white bear? And that causes us to think of white bears over and over again. Now, Wegner also demonstrated this in a number of other studies, other types of ironic processes of mental control and other counterintentional effects, like having participants do a golf putt. So they try to putt a golf ball into a hole, but they're told specifically not to overshoot. You know, try your best to make the shot, just don't overshoot. And, of course, in some conditions, this actually causes people to end up overshooting more often. So this is another demonstration of how we don't have full conscious control over our behavior. Now, we can sort of roughly divide our mind up into two main parts. So this is known as dual process theory. And the idea is that we have conscious processing and unconscious processing, and they're both happening at the same time. So we have these two systems, and these are called System 1 and System 2. And System 1 refers to the unconscious processing. Right? And this is also sometimes called the fast pathway or the low road. And the idea is this is like the quick and dirty processing that we do. And it happens beneath our awareness. So we have this system that's collecting and analyzing information, and it's happening without us being aware of it. And so this is System 1. And then System 2 is the conscious processing that we are aware of, that we have conscious access to. And this is also called the slow pathway or the high road. And the idea is this is where we can sort of deliberate and consider things and make decisions. So how can we demonstrate differences between these two systems? Well, when people think about the unconscious processing and this low road or fast pathway, there's a tendency to think of it as being primitive, right? Because people think about the old brain or the reptilian brain, as it's sometimes called, you know, these subcortical structures, limbic system, the hypothalamus, and there's this tendency to think of these as being primitive, but we really shouldn't. It's really the opposite of that. These are the structures that we've had the longest, and so in that sense, they're the most refined, right? They have specific tasks, and they're very, very good at doing those tasks, and they can do them very, very quickly. And so, for instance, with the idea of being startled by a snake, right? You don't want to be consciously doing that process. It's too slow, right? You want to have a system that's been built and refined over millions of years of evolution that causes you to immediately be startled by snake-like things that enter your field of vision. And you're actually able to have the startle response before you can even consciously recognize it as a snake. You don't wait for that information to go all the way back to your occipital lobes and be processed and say, okay, it's, you know, this is this particular type of snake. That's too slow. You want to be startled before that happens. Now, the other thing that we see here is that we can't take conscious control over these unconscious processes, no matter how much we try. So this is seen in something that Darwin tried to do, where he went to the zoological gardens and he tried not to have a startle response to a snake. So he put his face right up to the glass where there was a puff adder snake, and he told himself he wasn't going to move. You know, I'm not going to flinch. If the snake moves, I'm going to stay exactly where I am. And of course, the snake lunged towards him, and he immediately jumped back. Right? And he wrote that my will and reason were powerless. Right? And this shows the power of these unconscious processes, that we can't take conscious control over them, and that's a good thing, right? Because when we take conscious control, we do stupid things like trying not to jump back from a snake. I mean, you know, anybody in our evolutionary past who was trying to do that probably end up getting attacked by a snake and dying, right? So that was probably not a wise choice. So we have this unconscious processing, we don't have control over it, and generally that's a good thing. And this is in addition to all the non-conscious things I talked about in the previous video. Things like controlling your heart rate or your breathing or your digestion. You don't have conscious access to these things, and that's a good thing because it means you don't have to worry about them. They take care of themselves. Okay, so this is dual process theory. We might wonder about the relationship between unconscious and conscious decision making. Some of this unconscious information that's being collected, is that influencing our conscious decision making, and how? So this brings us to a potentially controversial subject in psychology. It actually wasn't all that controversial a few years ago, but now it's more controversial. So how did this happen? Well, there's been this replication crisis in psychology recently, as people are calling it. And this is the idea that many classic studies have failed to replicate. So researchers try to repeat the studies, and they end up not finding the same effect. And so one focus of this replication crisis has been research on priming. So I'm going to describe priming here. I'm going to talk about a well-known study on priming with the caveat that there's a great deal of controversy on the concept of priming and exactly how these subtle influences influence our behavior, or subtle cues, I guess I should say. Okay, so what is priming? Priming is the idea that certain mental associations can be primed, and this can happen unconsciously. We can sort of activate certain ideas in people's minds, and that this can then influence their behavior without them being aware of it. So the famous study on this was conducted by John Barge and colleagues, and maybe you've heard of it. It was a study where participants did a word task, and some of the participants were exposed to words that were meant to prime stereotypes about the elderly. So words like bingo and Florida and nursing home. And the idea was they were going to prime these participants without the participants realizing this, right? These words were just mixed in the task with other words. And then the researchers discreetly measured the time it took participants to walk down a hallway after they did the word task. And what they found was that the people who had been exposed to these elderly-related words walked more slowly down the hallway. And they said this was evidence for this priming effect of this unconscious influence on behavior. Now, as I said, there's been some controversy over this, and I'll post a link in the video description to the Psych File Drawer website. And this is a website that catalogs replication attempts in psychology. And you'll see that the top viewed study on this site is this study by John Barge and colleagues. And it's failed to replicate a number of times, although there's also been some successful replications. And so it's not really clear exactly what's going on here. Now, my view is that I think priming is probably a real thing. There are probably ways that unconscious cues can influence our behavior, but exactly what those cues are and exactly how they influence our behavior and exactly how we can measure it is probably what a great deal of the debate is over. And, you know, we see some sort of perhaps exaggerated claims about just, you know, how subtle something can be and just how large the effect on the behavior can be. But I think it makes sense that we can activate associations and they can influence us later. So for instance, if I were to talk about sports or talk about playing with your dog or something, and then a few minutes later, I ask you to do a word task and I ask you to, like, you know, come up with some four-letter words here. Well, you might come up with ball more quickly if I was previously talking about sports, right? Whereas if I had been talking about fashion and shopping, you might come up with mall. And you might not necessarily be aware of this influence. You might not realize that it was because I was talking about sports earlier that caused you to come up with this. So, but this would be a subtle effect, right? Not like a major change on your behavior. Now, another way we can see unconscious influence on behavior is what's called the mere exposure effect. So the mere exposure effect is the idea that when we've been exposed to things previously, when they're more familiar to us, we tend to like them more. Now, this makes sense. If it's a face, let's say, if I've seen a particular person a number of times and nothing bad has happened to me, you know, they haven't attacked me or harmed me in any way, then this is probably a safe person to be around. So I can sort of relax and feel more comfortable, and I might find myself liking this person more than a face that I've never seen before. Because, like, who knows what this person could be? Maybe they're going to harm me in some way. Maybe they're dangerous. I don't know. I don't know anything about them. Whereas the other person is like, well, okay, I've seen them a few times and nothing bad happened, so they're probably okay. Now, this makes sense, and this idea of familiarity and fondness being associated is logical, but the interesting thing is that this mere exposure effect occurs even when we aren't consciously aware of being exposed to the stimulus beforehand. So we've seen a face a bunch of times, but we don't remember seeing it. We don't know that we recognize it, and it still influences how much we like that person. So this has been demonstrated in a number of studies by Robert Zients. And one of the things that Zients did was he exposed participants to Chinese characters. And these were people who didn't read Chinese, so they couldn't understand the characters. And in fact, he exposed them to the characters so quickly that people didn't know they were seeing Chinese characters. So they were flashed on a screen too quickly for conscious awareness. But they were unconsciously seeing these characters. And then what Zients did was he asked people to rate some Chinese characters. He showed it to them, you know, consciously, where he said, look at this character. How much do you like this character? Do you think this is a positive or a negative word? And what he found was that people tended to like the characters that they had been exposed to previously, even though they weren't even consciously aware of the earlier exposure. Right? So this indicates this unconscious influence on our conscious decision making. So now they're asked to rate these characters, and they give them more positive ratings. They think that they guess that they'd be more positive words, and they tend to say they like them more. And this has been demonstrated with other stimuli as well, not just Chinese characters, but also with made up nonsense words or even with faces. All right, now this brings us to consider how advertisers might be using this mere exposure effect, right? Now, most people, when they think about advertising, say, advertising doesn't influence me. Right? Everybody seems to say that advertising has no effect on them. But of course, it must have an effect because we can see that advertising works. I mean, advertisers spend billions of dollars putting products in front of our faces and they get a return on that investment. So, what's happening is it's not a conscious process, and this is why people say the ads don't affect them, because consciously they really don't. It's not the case that you watch an advertisement and you immediately run to the store and buy the product. And if that were the case, you would have to admit that ads influence you, right? You'd say, yeah, I was watching TV and then this ad came on, and then next thing I know, I was in the store buying the product. But that's generally not how it works. Instead, it's unconscious processing. We build familiarity with a particular brand or a particular product. And then later, when we're making a conscious choice about, you know, which brand am I going to buy here, that idea that this one is a little more familiar to us, even if we're not aware of this familiarity, might cause us to be more likely to buy that product rather than one of the competitors next to it. Right? So this is probably a way that we have this unconscious influence on our conscious behavior. And again, one way we can see that it works is the fact that advertising works. We see that, you know, putting ads in front of people's faces causes them to buy those products more, even though the people don't consciously admit to this. Okay, so these are some ways of thinking about mental control and thinking about just how much control we have over conscious and unconscious processing and how it might influence our behavior. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.